I'm Mavis Wilson. Nicholas Jennings writes about the Canadian music scene, and in his book, Before the Gold Rush, he talks about the summer of 69. My friend Peter and I missed out on Woodstock. In the summer of 69, we were simply too young to make the trek, but we did get to go to an all-Canadian version of that historic festival. Held in a campground near Orangeville, Ontario, over the Labor Day weekend, the Freakout at Rock Hill Park featured no fewer than 21 of Canada's best bands on three stages, including one on a small lake. We soaked up some great music that weekend by the likes of the Guess Who, Lighthouse, the Five Man Electrical Band, and Motherlode. To us, those bands were homegrown heroes, local acts that had gone on to become stars. And who brought those stars to Rock Hill Park? My dad, J. Elwood Hill, Mr. Rock Hill. He was larger than life. He was a big man with big hands and a big, special laugh that you would recognize anywhere. His five daughters were embarrassed by that laugh. Elwood's father lost everything in the crash of 29. And following the Great Depression and the death of his dad, Elwood inherited the farm with a mortgage and a 15-year-old car with a bank loan, 5 of 7 cows with tuberculosis. Much of the farm wasn't great for farming. Limestones, big and small, were all over the land. But Elwood knew some other things about that land. The rock formations of the Niagara Escarpment broke through on the property. There were caves and crevices to explore, and from the top of the cliff, there was a magnificent view of 6 townships. The springs that fed the Boyne River were also on the property. In 1955, the bank loaned Elwood the money to follow his dream. He wanted to create a cottage development around 2 spring-fed lakes, and he called this development Springwater Lakes. Then, with the cottagers enjoying their private resort, people still kept coming, wanting to have picnics around the lake, and this gave Elwood an idea. He turned to the eastern portion of his property and developed a campground and a picnic ground with its own swimming pool, a man-made swimming pool. And this he called Rock Hill Park. My mom, Jean Hill, was an enthusiastic and hardworking partner in each of their endeavors. And my sisters and I, we spent our childhoods picking up garbage, up cooking French fries and cleaning washrooms. We were a musical family, and Dad thought the campers and the local folks might enjoy music too. He started Saturday night dances and Sunday night talent shows. And on each of those shows, Dad wore this hat and performed. I particularly remember Blue Eyes Crying in the Rain and Your Cheating Heart.
Your cheating heart will make you weep.
At first, the talent shows had local performers and local audiences. But soon, the contestants were coming from further afield, as were the crowds, which were getting bigger. Elwood had an ear for music and a heart for homegrown talent. Juno and Country Music Award winner Carol Baker performed on one of the earlier talent shows when she was just 13. She didn't win, but Elwood encouraged her and told her there was a future for her in the music business. Joe Firth and the Promised Land, Johnny Burke, Gordon Audie Henry worked on their careers on the stage at Rock Hill Park. And Stompin Tom Connors credited Elwood with giving him his first big musical break.
Hello out there, we're on the air, it's hockey night tonight.
As the park's popularity grew, so did Elwood's vision. His idea to bring in the big country acts from Nashville was a big gamble. But the stage on the water, known as the Showboat, featured the biggest acts over the years. Kitty Wells, Freddie Fender, Ronnie Prophet, the Oak Ridge Boys, Conway Twitty, Tom T. Hall, Johnny Rodriguez, Grandpa Jones, Ferlin Husky, Tex Ritter, Wilma Lee and Stoney Cooper, they were the first ones, Stonewall Jackson, Dottie West, Wilf Carter, Webb Pierce, all performed there. But with the crowds growing from 2,000 to 15,000, the stage area had to be moved to another area of the property. And there performed Charlie Pride, Barbara Mandrell, and Willie Nelson. And along the way, Rock Hill Park began being referred to as the Nashville of the North.
Blue eyes crying in the rain.
Before and leading up to Woodstock, and before the Rock Hill Park freakout, there was a lot of bad publicity about hippies and drugs. Hippies would tramp your grain fields.
The big thing at the strawberry fields was the rock sounds, and they were there this weekend with many big names.
They would give drugs to your teenagers.
Drugs openly sold like hot dogs at a country fair.
They would engage in nudity.
With temperatures in the 80s, clothes were quickly shucked.
There were obstacles along the way. There was fallout from the freakout. Despite the boost to the local rural economy, food, gas, motel rooms, local jobs that Dad provided for people, Mulmer Township Council, in a mean-spirited move, made Elwood pay for the salting of the gravel road from the highway to the park. And there was a great deal of nastiness locally. It was discussed and debated in the provincial legislature. Dad would spend 3 days in a Toronto courtroom fighting an injunction to stop his festivals. He was determined not to be put out of business. In the end, there were some time constraints, but he went ahead and had two other festivals scaled down in the summers of 1970 and 71. And the big country shows continued on into the 80s. Waylon Jennings was booked for a big show, but he wasn't allowed to cross the border. He was facing drug charges in the US. Dad had an audience there and no headliner. Then he received a phone call from Tommy Hunter. Elwood, do you need help?
When his right foot stomped the pedals.
And he came and put on the show. The audience was offered their money back, but very few actually came and asked for it. These were all outdoor concerts, and rain was the worst thing that could happen. One summer, it seemed to rain every weekend, and I remember as a child thinking, God doesn't love our family anymore. When megastar Willie Nelson was coming, the crowd was expected to beat all records. 40,000 were planned for. But it rained all weekend long. It really dampened spirits and profits. And as one newspaper printed, the crowd got drenched, but the promoters took the soaking. Stompin Tom Connors, in his autobiography, Before the Fame, writes about Rock Hill Park. He was at the Shelburne Fiddle Contest performing in the park. He ran into a guy by the name of J. Elwood Hill. He was running the big stage shows at Rock Hill Park, Ontario, and was due to bring in Hank Snow to play in the very near future. Tonight he was just roaming around listening to some of the stray talent, and when he heard me sing and play, he asked me if I'd like to appear on the Hank Snow show. Tom didn't believe him. He thought it was just some guy out trying to make an impression.
Set the table and tell us how the bingo went tonight. We'll go right.
But a couple of days later, this Hill guy called and asked Tom to be at Rock Hill Park on the afternoon of the 19th of August. And what professional name, if any, did I go by when I was performing? He wanted to include it in the newspaper ads. But when he hung up, Tom still didn't quite believe it. A few days later, I had to eat my words. An envelope came in the mail with a newspaper clipping in it.
between Reg saying, "I told you, Tom," and Muriel saying, "Oh my God, that's wonderful," I had a hard time reading the ad. In big bold letters it said, "Hank Snow and the Rainbow Ranch Boys, appearing August 19th at Rock Hill Park." In smaller letters, just below the words "also appearing," were a number of other names, and at the very bottom of the list, I almost choked up when I read the words, "and special guest star, Stompin Tom Connors." Today, the Niagara Escarpment Commission has helped the Bruce Trail with owning the 26 acres of the property where the caves and crevices come through. Elwood would be so happy that people who appreciate that, as he did, are able to be there. And I wonder, do they hear the ghost of Stompin Tom singing the hockey song? Or do they hear Elwood's special laugh? Every time I think of him, I remember that laugh, and I wish that I could hear it again, for real.